Welcome to the next lecture of this lecture series by Craig. So today Craig will be talking about polyoxometallics in material science. And he has been talking about different fundamental aspects of coordination chemistry and polyoxometallics. So now he will be talking about polyoxometallics and their applications in material science. But he will build from the basics. So basically it will be a continuation of the lecture series that he has been giving over the past few years, where he will touch the base always on the basics and then go on building it up and show you illustrations.
I think it may be most effective to stay in a very informal mode. Generally, we all learn the best by being able to ask questions. I also see what we can. If you have an issue, it's not clear, if you have a question, just, you know, raise your hand and we can discuss it. I promise to be give you a fairly clear answer as best I can, and a fairly quick one, so we can keep moving on. So Schoen's group's doing a lot of interesting material science. We had a 7 or 8 hour session yesterday, and it's my view that you guys are doing a number of quite interesting things. So we talked about the politics of publication. You can have great research, but you know, there's a lot more to getting your PhD, and there's a lot more to being a research scientist or an administrator than just getting experiments to work. So getting experiments to reproduce is crucial. It all starts there. And you get better and better at writing. If you want a journal that people will read, high impact factor, it's in English. So practice makes perfect, doing the experiments, learning how to make them more reproducible, and learning how to write it up in a compelling way in English. And when I say a compelling way, it's easy to write up science so it can put people to sleep. You don't want to do that. You want to have the title focused and excites. Okay, I've helped some people here. I won't mention the PI's names, the professor's names, but I've helped them with their titles. It all starts with a title. It has to be succinct, meaning a few words, exciting, and convey the meaning of the paper. A lot of papers only have one theme. It's easiest to write if your paper is just one theme rather than two or three. As soon as you have two or three themes, no problem. Two or three different themes, then it becomes harder to keep your effort focused. So it starts to decrease the impact of your manuscript later on in the publication. You guys, again, are doing a number of innovative things, I think, at the interface of PLS and material science. And I learned a couple of things yesterday, thanks to you, so that's good. The way things work is that collaborations are really good. They're getting more popular in the United States, and I think worldwide. One reason for that is that the problems that people are working on today are really big. They're multidisciplinary. And there's less and less interest in classical chemistry research problems. And the consequence of this is that there are some areas of classical chemistry that are kind of doing better. They're healthier now than others. And it's because they lend themselves more to overlap with other sub-disciplines, other areas, scientific and chemistry research areas. So material science is quite hot worldwide. In the United States, the funding for material science is higher than for all of chemistry. Yes, the funding for the National Science Foundation, the main thing that funds pure science, okay, not the main source of money for research, but the main agency whose mission is to support pure and fundamental science, spends more on material science research than it does on chemistry, all of chemistry, and all the disciplines. So that says something about what is hot and what is not, which is my phrase. So say we can all work on things that are interesting to us, but they may not be that interesting to other people. And it's just common sense and it's the politics of science to work on things that are really, really active areas. You have more meetings, you have more opportunities to get funding for your students, postdocs to go to meetings, and so on. So when you publish, your work will have a higher impact. And it will simply be, people will be more interested. So you'll have more citations, whatever. So these are all important things beyond the laboratory. You want to be successful? We all want to be successful. So there's a lot of things that you need to learn. I've been around a long time, right? So, and I have a good memory, so I've learned a lot of things. And I enjoy sharing those with people that are young and still, if they're young, and learning chemistry. They're also learning politics, so I can, you know, be helpful, and I enjoy helping people. So let's turn to this topic today. And I'll talk a bit about some of our work in material science, but I do want to keep the channel, this show a little bit open. We've gone through a lot of fundamental, important aspects of chemistry in this series of lectures. For example, we've talked about Marcus theory, which is the overriding theory that explains electron transfer, but by extension, it explains a number of reactions, additional reactions, including atom transfer reactions. Transferring oxo groups has been a hot topic for a long, long time. It's still a big community. There are people that are looking at the transfer of oxygen atom on a metal to another metal or an organic or biological molecule. An illustration of this, why metal terminal oxo compounds are still interesting, is that the most steady dense on the last 40 to 50 years is cytochrome P450. So this is a class of enzymes that's found in all living things. It's found in all organs of mammals. We're mammals. So it's found in our brain, liver, spleen, kidney, heart, you name it. And cytochrome P450 is an iron enzyme. And it goes through a catalytic cycle that was pretty well worked out by both chemistry and biology groups in the 1970s. And they refined their knowledge in the following years. It's interesting because you go to an oxo iron, a high valent iron intermediate, which is extremely potent. It'll oxidize almost everything. Not water and not alkanes, but almost everything else. There are enzymes that oxidize alkanes, methane monooxygenase being most studied, and of course, the oxygen evolving center in photosynthesis, which oxidizes water to oxygen. So they all involve metal oxo species. So this is an example of an area that's been hot for a long time and still is active. There's a lot of interest in it. Okay. I acknowledge the people that have funded me over the years. So we saw this slide, went through it, but all of these points, I'll just note quickly, they apply to POM materials of all kinds. So these are fundamentally important things throughout chemistry and biology. You have to have things soluble or you can't do anything. You can't make things if they're insoluble. Synthesis is very hard in solid state. In crystals, for example, you can do it, it's just very hard. It's very hard to control. Again, POMs are highly charged, typically charges of 6 to 15 minus, with the Kepler H, the giant ones, having charges as high as 70 minus. So there's that many cationes. But the cationes can be exchanged, so that allows you to have solubility not just in water, but organic solvents and fluorocarbon media, which again has uses. Potentials we've talked about, just to summarize. Potentials are dictated by the actual metal, vanadium versus aluminum versus tungsten versus something else. They're, number two, dictated by the negative charge density on the POM. Any negative charge POMs are much harder to reduce because they're already negative, and electrons are negative. But when you reduce them, they're much stronger reducing agents. So that's modulated in chemistry and in a number of areas in biology, including the oxygen-evolving center, by cationes at ion pair. So if you you reduce PLM first, it becomes more negative. You can compensate that growing energy, that growing charge. You can neutralize it by protonation or ion pair. H plus, M plus. So ion pairing is really important. Now, I've got a full talk on that we never got to. If there's interest, I can go through some of those slides. But there's a lot to go through in just 8 or 9 lectures. Okay, then the potentials in the thermodynamics role is very, very important. But actual rates are critical as well. You have to have driving, reasonable driving forces. What Marcus' theory tells us is that the more downhill a reaction, the more negative, exothermic, exergic, that's delta G, the reaction is, the faster it goes. The Marcus theory also says that at a certain driving force, there is no activation energy. So that means that's a maximum rate. And the minimum temperature dependence, essentially no temperature dependence. And then Marcus theory finally says that there's this weird region where the driving force is extremely downhill and the reaction starts slowing down again, the activation energy is going up. Okay, so electron transfer rates and electron transfer generally has been the most studied reaction in polyester metallic chemistry and probably in history. If you look at all of the enzymes, all of the catalysts out there, all the chemistry and biology. And so these various theories, with Marcus being the most effective, they give us a guideline from which we can understand quite a few other things. So the other things are simplest interactions. So PMs can do many things. That's the origins of material science in many cases. You want to build a material with PLM, you need to understand it's what the counter ions are doing, how they're affecting all these properties. Because you're going to first self-assemble your material. It can be a soft oxymetallate, a la Chomot-Royce group, or something else. But as it comes together, starting with the synthesis, the counter ions matter, and all the reactivities that you're going to see with those materials, any POM-containing or POM-based material, including these very important classes of reactions, all of that will be influenced by the counter ions and how much ion pair you have, as well as other factors. So all of this that we've talked about last time in more detail, go to the point now, my orange bottom line for today, is that POM materials, there's many of them. I'll go into that next, give a kind of an overview. But all these materials have this range of intrinsic properties. Many of them are tunable and in a fairly straightforward way through synthesis. Okay, so let's look at PLMs. I've modified these slides, all of them. On this slide, I converted this to green. Green for go. Now we have green signals all over the world. We want to be enthusiastic and move forward, not red lights. Of course, in Calcutta, you don't have either one. You just drive like hell and hope that it's starting. Extremely entertaining. Great adventure. So I converted this, and I've added a few things to my circle of things. So first, the most currently useful POM-based catalysts are the catalysts. And there are the two types, acid catalysts. Again, POMs are highly negatively charged. And usually make them in water, in acid. So the counter ions are not protonated. You're not protonating the oxygens, because the oxygens on the POMs are extremely acidic. You're in water, so you have hydronium ion or protonated water as your counter ion. Then the way you get these POM catalysts, PO-derived catalysts, useful, the acid catalysts, is you heat them up, you drive off the water, and the proton then, if there's no more water left, moves from the protonating H2O to protonating the POM oxygens. But the POM oxygens are, or the protonated forms, are extremely acidic. How acidic? The pKa's are below zero. Water is zero, essentially. PMs are a great deal more acidic, so they've measured some values as low as minus 10 but you can't do a titration of something in a solvent, certainly not water, if the pKa is minus 10, because you can't go below zero in water. So you would need to move to another solvent, which is much harder to protonate. So every solvent has a window between two pH values where it's a liquid and it's not protonated or deprotonated. So we know water, right? Water is a liquid between pH 0 and 14. I'm not including H2O in the mass action expression. If I do, then 14 is 15.7. So between 0 and 14. So below pH 0, if you have some other molecule dissolved in the water that's more acidic, you know, intrinsically more acidic, doesn't matter because the acid will be protonated water, because the water in the solvent is more basic than the thing that's dissolved in the water. So you need to get away from water and go to solvents that are harder to protonate. That is, where they protonate is far more acidic. So you can run these sulfuric acid. The famous solvents here, many used by George Olah, who was one of the pioneers of superacids and won the Nobel Prize for this about 20 years ago, and he died recently at age 82 or 3, something like that. Same age as C.N.R. Rao, most famous chemist here in India. And George published about the same number of papers as Rao, 1600, something like that. He won the Nobel Prize, though, because he was the first to realize that you really get strange reactions taking place when you go to solvents that are hard to protonate. So they're intrinsically very weak bases. And he, and so George, not Whitesides, but Olah, Whitesides is absolutely deserving of the Nobel Prize, maybe most cited chemist, but that's another story over lunch or beer. So George realized that if he went to fluorinated or chlorofluorinated solvents, that they would be extremely hard to protonate. And he found that when he had acids like Bronsted acids, where the proton is on a very low negative charge density PON, like or molecule, perchlorate is your obvious example. So perchlorate, you have five atoms, and you have one negative charge. So that's one negative charge divided by five atoms. Nitrate has got four atoms, so HNO3, nitric acid, is less acidic than perchloric acid. Dr. Hayashi talked about this. He gave a structural basis of it. There's also a simple way that this is looked at in most textbooks. That's Pollock's rules, also called Bell's rule. And it simply says that the acidity of an oxo acid is dictated by the number of oxo groups, terminal oxo groups you have on the central atom, which also has an OH. So you're looking at the acidity of the H. So if you have one oxo group like nitric acid, the pKa is plus 3. If you have sulfuric acid, you have two oxo groups, so the first pKa is 5 pH units more acidic, minus 2 or so. Perchloric acid, you have 3 oxo groups, so perchloric acid, Pollock's rule or Bell's rule, is a minus 15, so minus 7. And so it goes. Now consider PLMs. This is important for materials, applications, and everyone all and many of the others. Let's look at the charge density on the PLM. So let's take the most common PLM of all. It's been published in more than 1,000 papers. Anybody know what that is? Thank you. Relevant to your work. Pw1240, 3 minus, so you have 3 proton counterions. So it's normally water, so you have 3 hydrogen counterions. Again, as Shulman and others have talked about, proton and hydroxide both in water are complicated things. And I actually talked about that too. So, draw off the water, then the proton goes on to the other oxygens. Now you have something that's really acidic. So if you can get something like that dissolved in a solvent, which also is very hard to protonate, you have a super acid. And some of those have been commercialized. So that's the next point. On this, there are about 7 reactions that have been commercialized for PLM-based catalysts. about a third of them are using the PO1s as super acids. So, like, you take H3PW12, it's on the PO1 with the lowest negative charge, so it's the most acidic. H3PW12480 is more acidic than H4SiW12480.